Hey there, everybody. Pete Pardo here from Sea of Tranquility. It's been a while. I'm back. I've been traveling all over creation the last week and a half. I just got back a little while ago from Nashville, Tennessee. And I got to admit, I miss talking to you guys. All right. It's been a while since I've gone like almost a week without some sort of post here on the channel. So I got something quick for you today. A little book review. I actually read this on the plane coming and going. From Tennessee, we've actually, Chris Allen and I talked about this book a bit on our History of Judas Priest shows, but I actually just got done reading K.K. Downing's book here. It's called Heavy Duty, Days and Nights in Judas Priest with Mark Eglinton. There's K.K. on the front, K.K. on the back. So as you know, K.K.'s been out of Judas Priest. He actually retired from the band, geez, like nine years ago, something like that. And the band's obviously gone on without him, and he released this book earlier this year, kind of about all about his days in the band. So, you know, the book starts off, as most of these rock autobiographies do, where KK talks about his troubled childhood growing up in the Birmingham area, okay, and not a very happy childhood. You know, he had a strained relationship with his father. And he had two sisters and, you know, got interested in music and decided to kind of needed to get out of the house because he just couldn't take being around his dad anymore. And went out on his own and got involved in some bands, one of which eventually became this thing called Judas Priest with Al Atkins and a couple of Ian Hill and a couple other guys. And eventually, you know, Al stepped away from the band because they were having, you know, just having problems making it. And in comes Rob Halford and Glenn Tipton and various drummers over the years. And they got a record contract with Gull. You know, they released those first couple albums. And then they got signed to Sony. And then things really started to slowly take off for the band. So, you know, this, I personally thought this book was fun. It was entertaining. A little short. It's like 200 and it's just south of 300 pages. Like 275. You know, KK kind of, he's all over the place in here. And I do like his writing style, though. And I think you really get the impression reading this that KK was might have been one of the more sensible guys in the band over the years. You know, I guess we haven't really heard their stories, so can only go by this. You know, he takes some pot shots. He comes across a little bit bitter at times at kind of the way he was treated, you know, by Glenn Tipton and management for a while. It's just funny because at times he really kind of doesn't say some great things about Tipton, but then in other sections he talks about how they, you know, went out chasing girls and they went out playing golf and they went out shopping for expensive cars. And so I think there was some camaraderie there, although musically I think is where they had the issues. And he talks about this throughout the book. He talks a little bit about some of the stuff that went on with Halford. A few times he touches on a little bit of the, you know, Dave Holland leaving, and overall it's an enjoyable book. He talks about the issues that the band had with Iron Maiden at the beginning when Maiden were just an up-and-coming band. You know, he talks about some of the guys in Zeppelin, and he doesn't really get into a lot of like talking about guitars, which I kind of was looking forward to. You know, like what made him start to play Flying V's, and you know, he really doesn't get into a lot of that. Very little gear and guitar talk in here. You know, occasionally, he'll mention some of the amps or effects that he used at specific periods of time, but it's more like he glosses over like each kind of era in the band, kind of in conjunction with a lot of the album releases. Some of them he just kind of breezes through real quick. You know, he does talk a lot about you know, the groupies and the ladies. He does get into that quite a bit. And one of the central themes of the book, he starts off talking about how he has such a strained relationship with his parents, mostly due to his father, that continued on throughout his life. And that kind of forged the path to all the other relationships that he would try to have in his life, specifically with women in his life. So he, you know, he had one long-term girlfriend named Carol, who he was with throughout, trying to remember exactly, late 70s, throughout most of the 80s. But she was always at home, and he was always out on the road. And he makes it clear that, you know, he was not faithful to her whatsoever, but was expecting to come home to her whenever the tours were done. And she eventually got to the point where she's like, I can't do this anymore. And he talks about how each successive relationship that he had with women after that. Kind of the same problem just kept happening over and over and over again. Just these women got tired of waiting for him, and he just, you know, he went off and did his thing. And I mean, that could be a story for just about any rock star, right? I mean, we've heard these stories over and over and over again. So it's a common theme for a musician, life on the road, right? It's very hard to keep up a steady relationship back home, you know, and you're so used to being out there. When you do come home, it's almost like you want to go back out there again, but yet they're waiting for you to come home. So you get a lot of that in this book. And I honestly, it was a very easy read, a very fun read. I think his personality really comes across very well in the book. And I like that when you're reading someone who's writing about their life. And you've got a good sense of what it was like to be, you know, in Judas Priest. Again, from KK's point of view, do I think that his leaving the bands and what happened afterwards could have been done better? Yeah, I think so. He talks a little bit about how, when Judas Priest was up for a nomination for the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame last year, or 2017, I think it was, the management was already starting to put things together. Well, what if they do get inducted? How are we going to handle the ceremony? Is KK going to come? Is he going to play with the band? Obviously, that never happened because the band didn't make it in, but that may happen at some point. So he talks about that. He talks about, Halford leaving in 1992. And he kind of ribs Halford a little bit about how his solo career, with Fight and the Halford Band didn't really take off. And KK gives his opinion on the music and talks a bit about the Tim Ripper Owens era. Kind of really glosses over that because that's like almost a 10-year chunk right there after Halford left him before he rejoined. And he touches on those two albums briefly, says very good things about Tim Ripper Owens, which was great to hear. And then talks about getting back. What's funny is some of the albums that a lot of Priest fans maybe don't like nearly as much, KK really likes. And he talks about very fondly, like Turbo and Ram It Down, Jugulator, Nostradamus. He has a lot of good things to say about Nostradamus. In fact, in KK's opinion, the reason why Nostradamus didn't do well is because he feels they should have taken the whole 2 LP album, set out on the road, and done this big production thing where they played the whole thing, start to finish, and made like this whole like kind of rock opera thing about it, and done it in a presentation sort of atmosphere on the road. And he thinks that would have warmed up audiences more towards the album and the songs. Obviously, they didn't do that. They just went out and handpicked a couple tunes from the album, and then played it in their regular Priest Greatest Hits set, which he thinks is the reason why Nostradamus bombed and is not kind of looked at in such a better light. But then after all that, he kind of says, now that I'm looking back on it, in 2000, when did that come out? 2008 or whatever year that was. He's like, probably not a really great idea to release a double album of such magnitude because nobody has any kind of attention span these days, which is very true. This is not 1972. Had Nostradamus come out back in the early mid 70s, maybe a different story. Personally, I'm not a huge fan of the album because it's just not very catchy. I don't care how it could have been a single album. To me, the length doesn't really matter. It's just that you've got a lot of material on there that, yeah, it's finely produced. It's well orchestrated. It's pretty cool stuff. It's just not the Priest vibe for me. And nothing on there is really, really catchy. So, but he spent some time talking about that. But otherwise, a really, really cool book. I enjoyed it. I wish it was a little longer. He tends to really quickly go over a lot of points in time in here, which I wish he would spend, would have spent a little bit more time with. But, if you want to hear like the sex, drugs, and rock and roll type stuff, there's a lot of that here. A lot of talk, like I said, a lot of talking about the women, the ladies, and being off in all these tropical locations recording albums and not getting anything done because there's so many distractions, the bars, the drinking, the women. He gets into all that. So, in the end, I think he's at peace with his life in and out of Judas Priest, and I think he's enjoying his retirement, so that's good to see. This obviously was written before the most recent tour. He touches on Glenn Tipton getting diagnosed with Parkinson's at the very, very end, so they don't even get into the fact that they replaced Tipton for the tour, and that he had, obviously would have liked to have been called to take part in the tour, but they didn't. So that obviously happened after he put the finishing touches on the book. But a cool book. Check it out. If you're a Judas Priest fan, you got to have it, right? You got to read it, as I definitely had to. So I got more. You know, I know you guys like these book reviews, so I actually haven't done a autobiography show in a while, so I may do that because I definitely have some that I've read since the last one I've done. It's been quite a few months, so I may get back to that. But anyway, in the meantime, visit us on the web at www.seatranquility.org. We're on Facebook, we're on Twitter. Of course, we're here on the mighty YouTube as often as possible. I'm going to be coming right back at you. I'm not going anywhere for the foreseeable future. No more trips coming up anytime real soon. So you can look for a questions and answers show this weekend. I'm not sure exactly what day I'm going to get to it. I'm kind of tied up with a bunch of things, but I am going to get to that because I know I missed last week. I got a rant I'm cooking. Got a lot of top 10 songs. You know, honestly, and I would like to hear your thoughts on this. You know, I'm doing the top 10 song show. I'm doing the deep cuts on classic album show, and I'm doing the best to worst album shows. Judging by the viewership of all three of them, obviously the top 10 shows seem to be the most popular. I don't know as far as bandwidth if I'm going to be able to continue doing all three because sometimes they kind of overlap a little bit. I know I get some of you that really love each one on its own. I'll continue to do all three for the time being, but it may, you know, I'm looking at views right now. So if it seems like, you know, going for the next couple of weeks, the deep cuts on classic albums and the best to worst album shows are still lagging as far as viewership compared to the top 10 song show, I may decide to ditch those and just keep doing the top 10 songs. We'll see, because it all depends on how much time I have. You know, right now, I'm liking bringing you all this content and doing the diverse shows because I think it's fun and you guys seem to be enjoying it. But if it seems like, you know, one of these is not getting as many, you know, views as some of the other stuff, obviously we know why, right? Because you enjoy the other types of formats better. So curious to hear your thoughts on what kind of shows you really like. Maybe I'll put a poll up here on the channel so you guys can answer that. But if you want to drop some feedback in this one and just say, hey, which shows of mine do you really like? And which would you like to see me keep? You know, the top 10 songs, deep cuts, best to worst albums, you know, book and film reviews, the new product shows, history of bands. I know you guys love that stuff. The rants. You know, I do a lot of things on here. It's almost getting to the point of being unmanageable, so I may look to trim a little bit down. So let me know, all right? But otherwise, I'll see you guys later this weekend. Q&A, questions and answers coming up, and some other stuff. So, all right, take care. Oh, and I'm sorry I look like kind of crap today, but I just got off an airplane a little while ago. That's how dedicated I am to you, all right? I'm fresh in from out of town, and I wanted to deliver something to you. Plus, also, I just got done reading this, so I wanted to be fresh in my mind so I could tell you about it. All right, guys, later.